Good afternoon, everyone, from Marathon Stadium in Newcastle. Beautiful weather conditions. It's a lovely evening in Newcastle and a near-capacity crowd for this clash between the Newcastle Knights and the Northern Eagles. Wally Lewis and Russell Fairfax join me this afternoon. Wally, the Newcastle fans and certainly the Newcastle players well remember what happened at the end of last year. They looked almost certain to be into the grand final. They were leading the Roosters and then their world fell apart. They want to put it right from game one.
John, they had a spot in the grand final well and truly booked during that game, but something went wrong and the Newcastle players really well remember well and truly exactly what went wrong. The players, I suppose, have had a couple of months to muse over just what went wrong during that game. They know themselves that they couldn't afford to not want to win a game of football. They couldn't afford to rest on their laurels and wait for other people to do it. And I'm sure that there was a couple of players in there, particularly Johns himself, that well will remember just how painful that was.
Yes, they were all disappointed, no doubt, but no more than Andrew Johns, as he told Fox Sports' Andy Raymond during the week.
You know, I don't like to think about it too much. You know, it tears me heart out thinking about it. It's just a waste of opportunity. It's a waste of a year, really, when we should have won that game. But, you know, you can look at it positive or negative, and I look at it, it just might spur me on to train a little bit harder and push a little bit harder and make sure it doesn't happen again. You know, when you're getting tough, when it's tough to train and you struggle some loss of motivation, you just got to think of those games and how you felt at full time, you know, and I never want to feel those feelings again after a game.
Well, last year, of course, Tony Butterfield was the captain of the Knights. He's retired, and this year, Russell Fairfax, the captaincy falls on the shoulders of Andrew Johns.
Well, if you think Johns was upset at the end of last year, he was also upset at the beginning of the year. They went down to the Northern Eagles, 24 points to 14, and Johns, as skipper today for the first time, will be making sure that doesn't happen again. I think that's going to bring the best out in Johns' play. He's a fantastic footballer, and with the added responsibilities of leadership, which won't change his game, because he did run the show here at the Newcastle Knights. I think we're going to see a more mature and a more exciting Andrew Johns this year.
Whose side are you on?
With every NRL match every week, this is Fox Sports, where the game never ends.
Whose side are you on?
With every NRL match every week, this is Fox Sports, where the game never ends.
Whose side are you on?
With every NRL match every week, this is Fox Sports, where the game never ends.
A couple of very special guests join us. They're out around in the park somewhere. Here they are. Who have we got here? Mark Hughes from the Newcastle Knights. They're out there. And, of course, Danny Medeiros playing a bit of touch in the Today studio. And the boys will be on very, very soon. Now, welcome, boys. Welcome. Thanks very much for joining us, Chief.
Thanks, Fredman.
We all watched the Newcastle the other day, mate. They're missing a few forwards from last year, fairly. And
yeah, we are missing a few, yeah.
And you from a couple of years ago. Did they struggle, you reckon?
But I thought we'd done enough to win, to tell you the truth. I was a little bit disappointed. But their front rowers, Glenn Grief and Clinton O'Brien, I thought they played pretty well. Right. But, mate, all in all, I thought that the rule changes or the limited interchange really worked well. I enjoyed the football all the weekend. And I think some teams are really suited to it, like St George and a few other teams. But overall, I think it was great.
Joey Johns, how good was he?
Mate, Joey Johns tackled his backside out as well as doing many other things. So he's very important to our side. We all know that, but he's a great player.
Yeah. Are you any involvement up there at all with
Mike? Mate, I popped my head in the training a fair bit, a bit more than I probably have done in the past. But, nothing official. But as time goes on, I'd like to probably pop there a bit more.
Newcastle, of course, we've spoken about them already. They took on the Northern Eagles. Northern Eagles winning a tight one, 12 points to 10. But two of the players who really stood out for the Knights. Join us right now, Danny Medeiros and Mark Hughes.
Yeah.
Eagles. Eagles. Yeah. Too big, too strong, too fast.
Nothing. Nothing.
Big tough game though, wasn't it, up there in front of another big crowd? And you know, we expected a tough game. I'm surprised that we got you, actually. I mean, you're always really hard to beat up there.
Yeah.
What did you make of them?
Yeah, it surprised me they got us two in a way. They went really well. You know, obviously with Brett Camoli there now, they're a better team. The forwards went really well. We were pretty happy with our performance. We defended well and just got to improve a few things in attack, and, you know, we look forward to playing tomorrow night.
What did new coach Michael Hagan have to say?
Mate, well, obviously our defence was pretty good because we defended a lot of times, and I think we made 300 and some tackles. So with the new interchange and all that sort of thing, defence was good. But we panicked a bit with the ball, so we trained a lot with a lot of offence this week. And we've got to get it right against a red-hot Rooster side.
Just a couple of young players of the Knights, boys, just to go through them. Tamana Tahu, he's got an opportunity to be a superstar this year. But just tell us about Josh Perry, what you think of him.
Yeah, big Josh Perry. He only turned 20 about a month ago. And, you know, he's a really big, hard runner, and he's going to go really well. You touched on Tamana Tahu. He could be anything. Justin Ryder played on the wing for us last week and went really well. Yeah, so
that was a great try. Yeah. He stood up a couple and there was no room to move, and he got down there.
Yeah.
His nickname's Whippy. So he whips around. So
good to see Michael Hagan showing a bit of emotion there too when you got to the front. It's good to see a coach getting up and doing a bit of here.
Denny, playing in the forwards, mate, you've missed the big blokes. I mean, I know Chief's been gone for a couple of seasons now, but you lost Buttsy's leadership up front. You lost Dave Fairley, who had a super year for you last year. How was the feel out there?
Yeah, definitely. Clinton O'Brien, he's had injuries the same with Glenn Grief over the last 3 years. So Clinton's really starting to play well, and so is Glenn. So, mate, I think we're a lot smaller in the front rows. I'm probably the same size compared to Chief and Big Daisy. So maybe we're going to probably play a different game plan with the new rules. We're a bit more mobile, so we'll have to look at those sort of points.
And Mark, Matty Johns, I mean, you used to running some great balls off him. I mean, he's not there no more. I mean, how's the change been?
Yeah, for sure, Terry. Like, you know, I was lucky enough to run off Andrew and Matty during the early in my career. Matty's gone now, so we've got Matt Gidley maybe as a 5'8". At the moment, we've got Sean Rudder there, and he's doing really well, and I expect him to improve a lot in the next few weeks.
Beautiful.
Did you watch the Roosters on the weekend? And if you did, what did you think of them? Especially considering the fact that we look at the games last year, there's nothing between you. I think they got you first up with a late Fitzgibbon conversion, and then that dynamic game in the semis, which you probably haven't got too fond of memories about.
Yeah, definitely. That semi, I think we've got 10 players that are playing tomorrow night that played in that game, and 7 is different, didn't. And definitely the new coach, he didn't play as well. He's the coach. So, mate, it's sort of, it's a whole new feel, but obviously in the back of our minds, it's still there. But we want to go out and erase those memories.
It's an important match. We need to get a victory in the second round. You probably had a good look at the Roosters, but I think without a doubt their back row is superb. And like Adrian Morley, he's a damaging. He's 23 years of age. He's got the potential to be one of the best second rowers in the world, and Fletcher as well. So without a doubt, that's their strength.
What about injury, McDougall? When can we expect Adam McDougall back?
Talking to Dougs this morning. Hopefully he'll be back next week. So we were hopeful of getting him back for tomorrow night, but we look like hopefully next week we'll get him back.
And Matt Gidley's still a farewell, although Matt Parsons is back.
He's back, the big fella.
Big Parsons back, so...
Hey, boys, let's get our nitty-gritty. A couple of dead-set legends in Newcastle, these two guys.
Really?
Yeah, they live in Merriweather near the beach. And
live together, I believe.
They live together, yeah. And interesting to see who cooks and cleans. Steady girlfriends, top-notch guys. Who cooks? Who cleans? What's the go?
I'm more a steak. I cook the steak and veggies, and Danny's good at the chicken dishes. So,
is he getting any mince going like Fatty used to when he's a young bloke having the mouth?
Who puts the apron on? That's all I know.
We've got a gardener, we've got a cleaner, but anything we do is cook, and say good day to all those
Mark,
people out there.
They're talking about Ryan Cross, representative year this year, New South Wales. I mean, personally, as being a centre myself, I think you're as good as any other centre in the game out there. It should be a good clash. You're looking forward to it?
Yeah, definitely. Ryan Cross has started the year well, as he finished it well last year. He's a great centre, and you know, me and Tamana have got our hands full tomorrow night. Shannon Haggerty's also a good centre, so they're very quick out wide, so we're going to have to be on our toes to hold them.
Mate, chance of getting in that blue jumper? Give yourself some hope? I certainly do. I think you're a great player.
I'm just.
I just know what you're saying out the back.
Mark, who won't get my spot?
This bloke's a quiet achiever. I mean, last year I played against him a couple of times, and he's a fantastic player. He's an unbelievable defender, and I mean, he scored some of the great tries for Newcastle.
Well, that's a big rap coming from you because you're one of the best.
Without a doubt, I've played. Like, there's a lot of other centres out there getting a rap, and this bloke hasn't got a rap. He's as good as any of us.
Because the Eagles scored two tries last week, and you involved one of those holding the guy up over the line. That was freakish how you done that. So he's a great defender, Hughesy. Kid from Carrick.
Good on you. Listen, you blokes are also involved in coaching clinics with kids. Just run us by all that.
Yeah, we get out in the community of Newcastle and the country areas, do our best to get kids interested in rugby league. We're lucky enough to be helped by the ARL Foundation, who a few are in the crowd tonight.
Good on you, boys and girls. Well, there they are.
Over there. So they do a lot of work. Gary Larson, he's involved in that too. So, you know, we get out and try and encourage kids to play football and, you know, it goes pretty good.
Well, let's have a look at the boys in action with the kids clinic.
Yeah, thanks, Fatty. And how good am I going in there tonight? But today we're at Maitland Sports Ground and we're here with 250 kids. They're everywhere. They're ready to have fun. And as part of the Newcastle Development Program, we're here to see how they go. So let's check it out and see how they're going.
Here comes Billy A. Good girl.
Okay, so we've got Gary Larson here today. So what's your role here?
Mark, I work with the Australian Rugby League Foundation, and it's just recently started up, or when I say recently, the last 12 months, and we target the primary schools. We're development officers that go into the primary schools, and we hope to improve the profile of the game in the primary schools and get kids back to playing rugby league in primary schools.
Yeah, that's great. I've been watching. They seem to be having a good time. I helped out for a while. Was I of any help?
Mate, you are up to standard. You're a big help, especially with this throat.
Ball for Justin. Run the ball back out. Give it to number two.
I'm back in.
What about Denny Medeiros? Did he teach you anything?
Yes.
And what did he teach you?
Not much.
Go quicker. Up you go.
Who's your favourite team?
Nuts.
And who's your favourite player?
Skins.
Okay, and what is it about Marky? Is it his speed, his strength? What do you like about him?
Body.
I know, you just told me to.
Thanks, sir.
Who are your favourite teams?
Melbourne.
There you go, guys. Just an unsuccessful day out here. We're enjoying ourselves. What about yourselves, kids?
Yeah!
Oh, well then, I guess it's time to get back to our two very good hosts in there, Mark and Denny.
Yeah!
Enjoy your voice. Now, they're not the hosts. We know who the hosts are. We're back. I'll tell you what, it's great to see Gary Larson involved in that because he's one of the greats of our game and he'll do a great job with the ARL Foundation in that.
He sure will.
Yeah, he's got
Isaac's got the throat.
All right, boys, thanks very much. Please thank Denny Medeiros and Mark Hughes for us. Well done, boys.
Another big weekend of rugby league. The Newcastle Knights are out to pay back the Roosters tonight because the Sydney boys knocked them out of last year's finals. Now, we couldn't get Tony Braxton, unfortunately, for an interview on 10 Sport, but Tony Peters will have to do in a shirt and tie. He's out there at Sydney Football Stadium. Any late changes for either side, Tony?
Yes, Bulldog Bill, there is a change. The Sydney Roosters have lost. They've lost their front row forward Ian Rubin. He's been replaced by Andrew Lomu. Dallas Hood comes onto the bench. Newcastle Knights are as per big league program. And Adam McDougall returns to football next weekend.
What's Newcastle's record like in Sydney?
Pretty ordinary, Bill. Last year they won 1 out of 6 games in the Sydney metropolitan area, whereas the Sydney Roosters won 14 out of 16 here at the football stadium.
And what about this criticism that the Knights pack has shrunk?
Well, I don't know about that. They're still not pygmies, but they've lost a couple of monsters from last year. They've lost Butterfield, Fairley, Shields and Rahihi, leaving them light on for size and depth.
I think there's some fairness in the comment, but I would like to think that with Matt Parsons being available again tonight, who wasn't available last week, Ben Kennedy, Steve Simpson starting in the back row, I think we're going to match teams physically pretty well.
Tony, with such an intense game, as this is sure to be, is it an advantage to the Roosters to have a little more time to prepare for the match?
Well, the Roosters played last Saturday night. Of course, they were very impressive. They thrashed West Tigers. The following day, of course, the Newcastle Knights lost a tough game to the Northern Eagles.
It was a tough game, and it was Sunday evening, and they got a backup for a Friday night. So hopefully that comes against them, but it'll be a tough encounter.
Newcastle gets the chance to avenge last season's preliminary final loss to the Sydney Roosters when the sides meet at the football stadium tonight.
It was a lesson learned the hard way. Newcastle leading 16-2 in last season's preliminary final before a second-half capitulation ended its premiership dream. While avoiding the word revenge, the loss still haunts the Knights, in particular Brad Fittler's role in the Roosters' return from the dead.
As we found out last year, mate, he probably turned the game on his head in the space of 10 minutes.
The Knights head into this evening's game on the back of a first-round loss, and with queries surrounding their forward firepower, following the off-season departures of Butterfield, Fairley and Shields.
As I said, they might be the biggest pack in the world, but they're definitely mobile and they've got a lot of mongrel in them, so that's all you need.
Whether mobility and mongrel is enough could prove the key to the encounter. The Roosters boast an impressive pack, strengthened this season by hard-nosed English international Adrian Morley.
Like a lot of Australians are going over to England for the money, but I come out here to test myself and play in the best competition, so it's all new to me, and it's it's quite exciting.
Kicks off tonight with the Roosters hosting Newcastle. The Knights out to avenge last year's shock semi-final loss. The Roosters came back from 16-2 down at half-time, scoring four tries in 15 minutes to move into the grand final.
I think they'll all remember that. And that'll be a different side of the Tigers. A lot more attacking, so our defence will have to be in that game.
Snatching defeat from the jaws of victory has become the curse of Newcastle in their recent matchups against the Roosters. September 1998, and the Knights blow a 15-0 halftime lead to go down 26-15.
And the bench goes up as Sydney absolutely runs riot.
Lightning struck again last year in April. Up by 10 with 5 to go, the Knights go belly up.
He hits it and it is there.
And then in August, the most bitter loss of all. With a grand final berth up for grabs, the Knights collapse after leading 16-2 at halftime.
Going for the grand final. The Sydney Roosters are into the grand final.
Could Lightning strike a fourth time? We'll find out tonight on Nine's Wide World of Sports.
First, the matchup of rugby league heavyweights, the Sydney Roosters hosting Newcastle, two teams who may well be grand finalists come September. The match also features two of the world's best players head-to-head, Andrew Johns, Brad Fittler.
Just into its second week in a competition already living up to its pre-season hype. Newcastle out to avenge last year's semi-final loss to Sydney, but after absorbing a series of early raids, it was the Roosters who again had the bounce go their way.
The bounce is beautiful! Paul Green has scored!
Paul Green pouncing on a ball Robbie O'Davis had no chance of catching. But just minutes later, the little fullback was back in action.
O'Davis takes on a front row forward! He's rolled over onto his back. Has he got the ball down?
The video referee ruling O'Davis had grounded the ball. The match locked at 6-6. Defence then became the priority for both teams. Englishman Adrian Morley unsettled winger Justin Ryder. But with minutes counting down to half-time, Ryder returned to make the most of a towering Andrew Johns bomb. Anthony Minicello unable to clean up, Ryder crossing untouched. But from the kickoff came another crucial mistake. Josh Paul losing control and Ryan cross over to level. The score's locked at 12-12. But staring down the barrel of back-to-back losses, the Knights return fire. Minicello then made it two spectacular tries in as many weeks when he outjumped Ryder to again level the scores.
The kick in the jump is on, he's got it! He's got it! And he's put it down!
But it was Ryder who celebrated last, his second try securing a thrilling 7-point win.
It's Ryder! Ryder's in! Number two!
Some intriguing contests out wide there, and the Knights' campaign not looking too bad for 2001. The win not only relieving that disappointment of last year's semi-final loss, but also proving they have the ability to make an impact under the new coach, Michael Hagan.
Rugby League and Newcastle rookie Justin Ryder looks set to be dropped despite scoring two tries in last night's win over the Roosters. The Knight Ryder to make way for the return of Adam McDougall. A tough call for coach Michael Hagan.
Ready?
I'm back.
And back. Ready? Go. Yep.
They could be the next generation of Knight Riders. Newcastle coach Michael Hagan relaxing with family following last night's 25 points to 18 win over the Roosters. The Knights avenging last season's loss in the semi-finals.
But we're really focused about what we can do this year, and the fact that we're able to hang in at the end is a pretty tough game, and I think it's going to be tough most weeks. So we're very pleased to get the 2 points and open our account for the year.
After copping a heavy hit early in the match, young winger Justin Ryder bounced back, scoring twice for Newcastle. Now dubbed the Knight Rider, his next assignment is likely to be back in First Division. The 20-year-old making way for the return of Test winger Adam McDougall if he passes a fitness test on Wednesday.
I think it's fair to say if an international comes back from injury that he would probably understand that, although he's probably not entitled to be dropped at this stage on the basis of the last two games, but I'm sure he'll bounce back. And
last night's win is a confidence boost for the side following their opening round loss to the Northern Eagles. The makeup of the Newcastle forward pack had been under scrutiny, criticised for its lack of strength following the loss of Tony Butterfield and David Fairley. Hagan says the current front row is up to the job.
I thought they played very well last night against the Roosters pack, which has got some big names in it, and I thought even last week against the Eagles pack, they did quite well. So I think if they do their job every week, we've got some very good backs who can take advantage of that.
Roosters and Knights are two of the NRL's most skillful teams, but last night they were flat out just holding onto the ball. At times the kicking was just as bad, Fittler's radar well out, his effort matched by Brian Fletcher.
It's gone sideways, backwards. It's a shocker.
In between the fumbles and bumbles, both teams played some entertaining football. The scores were level at half-time, the Knights breaking the deadlock with an impressive backline move.
Billy Peyton's over the line!
Anthony Minicello soared to tie the game at 18-all before Robbie O'Davis chimed in perfectly, then offloaded to Justin Ryder for the winning try.
Ryder's in!
An Andrew Johns field goal putting the result beyond doubt. Chris Hodgkinson, National 9 News.
Last night at the footy stadium, Newcastle didn't make the best of starts. Paul Green and Luck combining for the Roosters to open the scoring. Both sides were guilty of some shocking handling as Newcastle chased revenge on the Roosters finishing in their campaign last year. Jason Perry produced the first brain explosion of the season with this pass. The Roosters gladly snapping it up. It was 12-all at the break. Both sides crossed for tries early in the second half, but it was Knights winger Justin Ryder who starred with a double for the game. Andrew John sealing the win with a field goal, the Knights inflicting some revenge.
It's okay.
Everything just clicked tonight and it turned out perfectly. The feet were working, the hands were working, and the side got away with the win.
Bernard Cohen, 7 News.
We're about to welcome the Newcastle Knights onto the Sydney Showground. The Knights Army has come down from Newcastle as they do every away game. What tremendous supporters of rugby league the Newcastle Knights are.
They certainly are a great rugby league town, and as I've always said, even back when there was a little bit of controversy a few years ago, rugby league will never die, whatever Newcastle is on the map.
And here come the Knights, led out by Andrew Johns, playing his 150th first grade game this afternoon. And what a career the magical number 7 has had for Newcastle, New South Wales, and of course Australia. The last man out of the tunnel for the Newcastle Knights, number 1, Robbie O'Davis. Crowd on here, on hand here at the showground on a beautiful afternoon. Quite pleasant conditions for watching football, and better conditions for playing than we've seen in the first few weeks of the competition. And the fans have come down from Newcastle by the busload once again. And they've got their team 2 points in front as Andrew Johns, game 150, brings them back out for the second half. And Ben Kennedy has had an impact in that first half. That last try, Steve Mortimer mentioned during the call to watch out for Kennedy. And he went as a decoy, and the Bulldogs went with him and opened it up there for Perry. Plays the ball back. Kennedy, Johns, out to Ryder. comes back away from the touchline. The Dogs try and force him back over. Inside the 10. Johns, long ball. Rudder juggles and gets it back. Still going. Last tackle. Where's Andrew Johns? What will he do? Passes to Kennedy near the line. Pops the ball. That try. What a rugby league try. To the diff with a kick to come right next to the post. The referee's calling someone out.
Amana Tau, who's been in excellent form here today, got away. And I thought the pattern man was going to miss, who's come up with a tremendous tackle. But it's Andrew Johns once again going nice and wide. Look at that short ball there. And what about that one there from Ben Kennedy?
He's
and
he kicks it. Conversion. We're all locked up at the showground. 80 seconds to go. The Knights never say die. They've done a Bulldogs on the Bulldogs.
On to rugby league, and tonight a thriller between the Bulldogs and the Newcastle Knights. The Bulldogs taking the field as the only unbeaten team in the competition.
A new home ground for the Bulldogs, plenty of blue and white to mark the occasion. Newcastle showed their colours early, but on the line was out. The Bulldogs making their first chance count. Captain Darren Britt with the perfect offload, Craig Polamounta and Luke Patton going on with the job. Newcastle's reply even more straightforward.
For the Knights, Perry fresh on the field, is he over? Can he get it down?
Another defensive lapse, this time from the Knights. Darren Smith taking advantage, but Newcastle went to half time with a 2-point lead.
Here's a chance, Perry! Try number two.
The Dogs came snarling out of the sheds, Paul Rahihi on a mission. Youngster Braithen Astor put the Bulldogs 8 points in front, their biggest break of the game. Then, with 9 minutes left, the Knights knocked the margin back to two. The Knights looking to hit the front again when it all went wrong. Bulldogs winger Hazemil Masri making them pay. And just when the match looked lost, the Knights never said never.
Passes to Kennedy.
The try converted, the match all tied up. And with just seconds on the clock, the Knights were away again. Luke Patton's last-ditch tackle ensuring the draw.
28-all, in fact, the Bulldogs still unbeaten, but the coach, Steve Foakes, it felt like a loss. He was unhappy about a crucial penalty that followed a touch judge's call on centre Willie Talau. Talau was placed on report for a tackle on Newcastle's Mark Hughes.
The referee was only about 15 metres from it. And he wasn't watching anything else. I just felt it was, he saw it. So I don't see why the touch judge, he saw it and was about to rule the scrum. I just don't see why the touch judge entered the field.
I think we're entitled to probably win the game. But we weren't good enough to take the chances that were there at different times, and there were some freakish things in the game that changed the course of the game.
Four players are to face the NRL judiciary after the weekend round, among them Dragons skipper Craig Smith and Melbourne centre Aaron Moule. But the Bulldogs are dominating league news today, unable to make the playoffs last year, and now on top of the competition after a round three draw with the Knights.
Alone on top of the league, who would have picked the Bulldogs to be the only unbeaten team after three rounds?
We're prepared to throw the ball around and move sides around and chance our arm a little bit more than maybe we have been the last couple of years.
Folks said there's also a fresh attitude in the team, and last night the Bulldogs fought a ding-dong battle with Newcastle.
Last year was sort of it was terrible, to be honest.
After only four wins at Stadium Australia last year, Hazemil Masri says at the Bulldogs' third home venue in 4 years, they could feel the fans lift them. The goal-kicking winger gave his team a 6-point lead 8 minutes from the end.
I stuck my hand out just to sort of stop the ball and popped up, so I grabbed it and ran, 55, 60 metres.
His conversion miss proved the difference, as Andrew Johns' brilliance 2 minutes from time initiated Glenn Greif's converted try.
What a rugby league try!
For Robbie O'Davis, who collapsed in the tunnel after treatment for a head injury, the game was almost surreal.
When I got out there, we were 40 points in front, and then I looked at the scoreboard and we're, 6 points behind. So
I might have been still a little bit dazed, I think.
Behind the Bulldogs, six teams are on 4 points, while the Panthers are still searching for their first win.
It's a very topsy-turvy competition. Everybody's beating everyone, and there's a lot of good teams around, and there is no easy game, so anyone can win it week in, week out.
Charles Christian, National 9 News.
Willie Lau has escaped action for an alleged head slam, although the club's angry the penalty cost them a win against Newcastle.
They might be the competition top dogs, but Hazeem El Masri and his teammates felt like they'd bombed it against Newcastle.
Absolutely, you know, I mean, 1 point is better than nothing, but it felt like a loss to us, to be honest, because we're leading all the way.
Up by two, the Bulldogs looked home when El Masri snatched an intercept with 8 to go. But the man chosen to fill Darryl Halligan's boots found the upright.
Mate, there's a lot of pressure on me, you know. Look, you're bound to miss one.
Down 28-22, the Knights had a hope, and with two to go, they went to Andrew Johns.
Passes to Kennedy, near the line, pops the ball, that try!
The Dogs will cop the draw, but they were 40, fuming 20. That Willie Talau was reported for a head slam.
Is dead set, got that so wrong.
Talau was today cleared, but the penalty led to a Sean Rudder try that got the Knights back into the match. Consistency from referees, again a concern.
Yeah, exactly. And they were frustrated, and I had a word with Andrew Johns after the game, and he said pretty much the same sort of thing. So.
And the second piece of footage comes from the Newcastle Bulldogs clash, and just have a look at Andrew Johns here. Exactly the same kind of play. Badiris, he finds Andrew Johns right in the last couple of minutes, and you could just see there, didn't look at Brent Kennedy, threw the pass, and Kennedy onto Glenn Grief. That was right in the last minute they converted that try, and Newcastle got away with the draw. So some telepathic work from two of our best, Scott Hill and Andrew Johns. Fantastic performances. Well,
the extraordinary thing about Andrew Johns' effort there, I mean, they were six behind with a minute to play, and he can come up with a play like that on tackle five to get his team across the line for a draw. I mean, skillful enough, but at the stage of the game it was quite remarkable.
What about a game of inches? Hazeem El Masri kicked well, hit the post. If it goes inside, they're in front by 8, they win the game. Mm. So
they played really well, Canterbury. They are going great guns out there.
Very good side.
Plenty of speed, and Steve Folkes doing a good job out there with the Canterbury Bulldogs. You've got a tough battle tomorrow night against the Knights up there at Marathon, and big Matty Parsons went out and did a little bit of spade work for us out there.
It's Matty Parsons here. It's a pretty miserable day at Marathon. It's pretty miserable for the Eels, hopefully, on Friday night. We've just finished a ballwork session, showing the boys a few tricks. We're just going to go and catch up with a few of them, see how the game's going to go on Friday night. Here you go with our skipper, Joey. He's just sniffing his undies, mate. How are we looking for Friday night?
Yeah, good, dog. I think we're a good bet.
Mate, how do you think the team's been going this year?
I think the team's been going well. Unfortunately, blokes coming off the bench haven't been going that well.
Yeah, I've got to agree with you, mate. We changed the game the other day. Josh Perry came on and scored 2 tries, and I let one in, mate. We're worth 18 points.
Yeah, something like that.
Mate, you said that we're probably playing at about 60%. That's pretty well right at the moment.
Well, I think every team's looking to improve, aren't they, after a few weeks, so we're probably no exception. Mate, I hope you interview better than you trained this morning.
That's a lie, mate. Everyone knows I'm a good trainer. And here's our try-scoring man from the weekend, mate. How was it to run that try?
Oh, mate, I didn't have to run too far. I only had to run about 2 moves and fall over, so it wasn't too tough.
Here we go. We've got Danny Badiris in the ice bar. He's looking good, too. He's got his rubber duckies in here. Mate, how's the ice bar?
Good.
Saw Hemi, mate. Mate, what's the idea behind the ice bar?
Mate, I don't know. Get some blood flowing and get straight in the height, and away you go.
Doogsy, your quad injury, mate. How are we looking?
Oh, you know, hopefully this weekend. So fingers crossed, looking forward to playing again. It's been a long time between drinks, so just biting at the bit to get back out, mate.
Mate, how about you run one in for me on Friday night?
All right, one in for you. Actually, I might pass it to you and let you score, eh? How
about Good on you, Alves. Mate, you've been playing strong, mate. Took a bit of a knock on the weekend. How'd you come out of that?
Yeah, I've took a bit of a knock, but my memory's fine. You know, I thought we should have beat Penrith on the weekend, and I'm sure we'll beat Canterbury this week.
So you've heard the boys, we're itching for our first win at home this week. We've got a big test, Parramatta Eels, but we're at home at Marathon in front of the best crowd in the NRL, so we're looking for our first home win. So it's on Friday night.
Yeah, plenty of talent up there, isn't there? We thank Matty Parsons for being involved with the Footy Show once again and taking the microphone. Guys, a trip to Marathon, what's that like heading up there?
Yeah, I've done it a few times. It's never easy going up there. Obviously, the crowd's the biggest factor up there. I think, like Matty said, I think he's got the second best supporters behind the Blue and Gold Army. But, you know, going up there is always tough. So we're we're expecting a very tough game, and they had a bit of success the last 2 weeks ago.
Nathan, you haven't done it as much, but what about heading up that way?
Yeah, it's pretty scary going up there, especially the crowd, as Matty and Mick just said. The crowd really gets behind them, and it's going to be a tough one, give you that.
Should be great. Well, boys, play well. Nathan, I hope your shoulder comes good, mate, and play well up there. This bloke, Noel Clear, was the best runner running forward I ever saw, and I tell you what, Nathan's not far behind him. So well done to you, Blakeson. Play well up there tomorrow night. And you'll see that at 8:30 p.m. Newcastle at home to the Parramatta Eels will be a wonderful, wonderful match, which will be well called, hopefully, by Ray Warren if he's sobered up. As we had Wayne Pearce on the show last week, he was heading out the next morning at 4 a.m. to do his first fantasy file, and here it is with Andrew Johns.
Welcome to our very first fantasy file for the year. In this segment, we not only encourage footballers to let their imaginations run wild, but we actually give them the opportunity to realise their ultimate fantasy. First up, we're here in Newcastle with one of their favourite sons. And another of their most famous surfing exports.
That looks like good, eh?
Well, Joey, I know your ultimate fantasy is to be a professional surfer.
Amongst other things, yeah. I think porn star is out of the question, wasn't it?
Well, at this stage it is. We might visit that later on. But we've got the best in the business here today to put us through our paces.
Me and Luke, porn stars. Oh, we're going surfing.
We're going to go surfing.
Oh, okay.
Luke, you.
Oh, is it?
And the junior. Oh, that's what it is.
The big waves, you get a bit scared.
I thrive on the adrenaline of surfing pipeline and stuff like that, and I really enjoy it, but there's one thing that I don't think I could handle is like talus running at me or something like that. That's really
it's easy.
A
bit soft boardy. Hope this doesn't go to Brisbane. What goes on the hoop, mate? What have we got to do?
Well, it's 25 minutes, best three waves. You're only allowed to catch 10. You're on my field now, mate.
Halfway through, I lost track of you, so we're going to declare it a dead heat.
Yeah, bullshit.
Let's just ask Luke how's Jeremy going?
Mate, you should keep the jersey on and the board shorts on the line, but you know, he's out there to have fun, and that's what he's doing other than playing football. And he does all right, this kid, he does all right in the surf.
What about the junior? How'd the junior go?
Junior, you're not too bad, but I think you lived in... Yeah, mate, a little bit too long, and we've tried you out on mall today, but
I got my very own boogie board, have I?
Your own board, there you go.
Style.
Let's go and see what you can do.
Let's go.
Good on you, Junior. Thanks very much for that, and it's just as well Junior could tackle because he's not much of a surfer.
He might be taking the stateside to the water, I'd say, instead of horse riding this year.
Marathon Stadium. For many a visiting team, it is a graveyard for dreams. It starts when the visitors run the gauntlet through a flock of rabid Knights fans to change in the most primitive dressing rooms in the league. There's a story that the ground staff hose down the visitors' room before they arrive, just to make it a little bit more uncomfortable. But then again, that's just a story. If that's not enough, there's 28,000 screaming Novocastrians ready to give it to you as soon as you hit the race. The Eels know this. They've only won one game here in the last 8 years.
Kennedy got the pass away. Billy Peden. Peden for the line. The skipper. Oh, they've come back from the dead, the Knights.
When you play the Knights at home, there's never any doubt where you are. And you and the Eels will know this tonight on Nine's Wide World of Sports.
Tonight, heavyweights and halfbacks, an early season highlight.
First one of rugby league's headline matchups, two sides blessed with power and pace. So well balanced, in fact, that the experts had anointed them as premiership chances. Well, at least one of them lived up to those raps in a stunning match at Marathon Stadium.
With only one win at Marathon in the last 8 years, Parramatta didn't need this from the kickoff.
And a mistake is offered early by Parramatta's Michael Buettner.
The Eels were let off the hook this time, but moments later, Jason Taylor threw a ball he would rather forget.
Oh, intercepted by Tahu. He's got a heap of speed. Tahu will go all the way.
While Lady Luck played her part in that try, she stood aside for sheer class in the Knights next.
He's over the line. Mark Hughes. Mark Hughes has scored.
A penalty for a late tackle gave Parramatta its only points for the half, and from the ensuing kickoff, more Eels errors.
He's knocked on here.
Taylor settled his team temporarily, but then tossed it up again. The next set of six, Mark Hughes in for his second.
Hughes will score!
If Parramatta was in a hole, Tahu dug a little deeper, standing up his man and grabbing himself a double.
He's looking for number two! He's going to make it as he is! Tahu's over!
Not yet half-time, and the Jason Taylor horror night continued as the Knights went to a 26-2 lead.
Rudder's pass was a bullet.
More pain for Parramatta fans after the break as the Eels' second half began like the first. The unforgiving Knights relentless, making Parramatta pay the full price.
O'Davis kicks for Albert. Albert leads the race by a mile. Albert picks it up. Albert will score. Darren Albert has scored.
Now 32-2, the avalanche of errors just kept coming for the Eels, but Newcastle had clocked off. Parramatta crossing for two late tries to put some respectability into the final scoreline.
And Hodgson's on his way. Albert's after him, but put away the glasses. Brett Hodgson puts it down.
Parramatta can no longer claim to have the league's best defence. Tahu and Hughes scored twice each. A better night for the boot for Andrew Johns, and it would have been even more damaging.
And the fact that we're able to get off to a 12-point lead in the first 10 minutes certainly... You know, I don't think Parramatta were expecting that, nor were we. So, but to actually go on with it from there, I thought was an enormous achievement by our blokes against what is the best defensive team in the competition.
I think we just made errors. You know, some of those errors we made at the start of the game. Yeah, you know, I'm trying to remember. I don't think we made an error off a kickoff last season, and we made two on the one night. So you know, that's you make a rod for your own back when you do that sort of stuff. It was an ideal preparation. We had a great preparation this week, and our boys tonight just didn't grasp the nettle as you need to right at the start of the game. We gave the opposition opportunities to put a lot of pressure on us. They came up with the big plays, and we were forever chasing our tail from that point on.
Last night, the signs were ominous for Parramatta from the kickoff. Newcastle quickly capitalising on a mistake-riddled Eels performance. Tamana Tahu picking off a Jason Taylor pass and scampering 70 metres for the first try.
Tahu will go all the way!
Mark Hughes chimed in with two of his own and the Knights were on a roll.
He's over the line!
Parramatta just couldn't get a grip on the football. While Tahu burst through some paper-thin defence for his second try, the Eels in disarray. Leading 26-2 at the break, Newcastle continued the rout early in the second half, Robbie O'Davis kicking for Darren Albert.
Darren Albert has scored!
The Eels were saved from complete embarrassment, crossing twice to narrow the gap, but the Knights were comfortable winners.
Two one-sided affairs to kick off round four of the NRL last night. Newcastle handed the Eels an 18-point hiding.
Last night, this mistake by Michael Buettner from the opening kickoff pretty much summed up Parramatta's evening. The Eels literally handed the Knights early points. That Jason Taylor pass, intercepted by Tamana Tahu, was the start of what turned out to be a nightmare for the Eels. Andrew Johns and Sean Rudder were the architects in a near faultless first half from Newcastle. Tahu grabbed a double as the home side led 26-2 at the break.
He's going to make it as he is!
Newcastle was kept to just one try in the second 40, but still finished very impressive 32-14 victors.
Is Darren Albert from the Newcastle Knights. Don't blink. 8:30 Friday when the Broncos tackle the Knights live. Primetime football this weekend on 9. How fast is Darren Albert from the Newcastle Knights? Don't blink. 8:30 Friday when the Broncos tackle the Knights live. Primetime football this weekend on 9.
Thanks for joining us for the footy show, and it's great to have you in the audience and wherever you're watching at home. Thanks for joining us, and I hope you have a good night tonight. We've got a great show planned. Our guests tonight included a couple of the Knights, Adam McDougall and Darren Albert, Adrian Moore. Yeah, they're going all right, the Knights, and they've got their big match, of course, up in Brisbane tomorrow night. The Week in League,
yeah. Some dramatic events, of course. Yeah. It started on Friday night. We went to Marathon Stadium, and an unexpectedly low crowd there, just over 11,000, but we found out the next day that the floods in northern New South Wales played their role. They came down as far as Maitland and Cessnock, so plenty of the Newcastle faithful couldn't get out to the game. But whether they were there or not, their spirits would have been buoyed with this performance. A big 32-14 victory over the Eels. Really wrapped up at half-time after a scintillating first 40 minutes. An intercept to start the night off. Now, play of the week comes from Friday night, and it's I love it when some creativity and initiative is rewarded, and it comes from this scrum win from Newcastle with Andrew Johns feeding. Now, you see, it goes out to Sean Rudder and goes to this man here, and what a season he is having. That's Robbie O'Davis. The pass came from Rudder. Now, as play continues on, and I'll get rid of those circles at some stage. There we go. The ball goes in behind. Darren Albert was just onside. Now, this is not an easy pickup. He is on the fly here. Got in behind Jason Moody. It's called M&M's, this move. They've worked on it before. And Darren Albert picks it up, goes around, takes it around closer to the posts. Not the first time we've seen Newcastle put that play on. M&M's. Won't be the last. Fantastic.
Hold on, Pete. That was the Weekend League. And, of course, also the Play of the Week. Is that one of your moves, the M&M move?
The old M&M, I brought that one in, mate, too.
Of course you did.
Chip and chase.
All right, well, speaking of Newcastle, they had a great win last Friday night. They feature in our match tomorrow night. They've flown up today to Brisbane to take on the Brisbane Broncos at ANZ. It'll be a tough one. They've never won there, and two of their players join us right now. Please make them welcome Adam McDougall and Darren Albert. Welcome, boys. First of all, Adam, well done on finally getting back into the team. You're fit and well and ready to go, eh?
Yeah, mate, it's been a pretty frustrating season for me. After last year's World Cup, as soon as I got tackled in the first tackle of the final, I knew that it was going to be a long time on the sidelines for me, and sure enough, it's been 6 months, and finally got to run the last couple of weeks. I've only ran four times since the World Cup final, and it's been a little bit frustrating, but I'm just glad to be back on the field tomorrow night.
So, Dugsy, let's get straight into the big clash between you and Windle. It's going to be tough for you, the fact you haven't played any football at all and you've got to play 80 minutes tomorrow night. You're looking forward to the clash, of course. Would you be expecting that much out of yourself after a poor preparation?
Yeah, Chief, I'm a little bit nervous, I must admit, and I wouldn't show that much disrespect to Wendell to say that I expect to get the better of him tomorrow night. He's too good a player. He's been at the top of the rugby league world for so long now, and as far as I'm concerned, I believe he's been the best winger that I've ever seen. So tremendous amount of respect for the guy, and tomorrow night I'm just really concerned about getting through 80 minutes of football, and first things first, if I can come off the field with no injuries and just hopefully play the full 80 minutes, I'll be really pleased with that.
Yeah, well, speaking of Wendell, he actually did some vox pops for us. He went out to the Brisbane boys, had a chat to them about this big match tomorrow night.
Hi, this is Wendell Saar from the Broncos. We've had a great week of training. Let's go on and talk to the boys and see how they're prepared for this week's game against the Knights. Here we have our new pin-up boy, the Broncos, Ash Harrison. How are you fitting in at our lock there, Ash?
Yeah, good actually at the moment. Last week was a tough game and first time I played 80 minutes for a while, but this week's going to be tough again. It'll be good to see how we go.
I'll tell you what I like about you, Ash. I mean, even if you don't have a good game, you look good. That's a great attribute to have on the field.
Yeah, well, after watching you for a few years, you sort of get to know that if you're at the Broncos, that's sort of what you're going
to
do.
Tomorrow night, we really need you to play well. And obviously, yourself and Shane have played pretty well. And blokes like probably Lockie and myself haven't aimed up to what we should. But tomorrow night's probably a good night for it.
Yeah, well, apparently Wendell's going to show up for us. He's been playing rugby for the first four games. So I think Wendell's making a guest appearance there, tomorrow night. And hopefully he can play good for us.
Here we have our new star fullback, Lottie Dakiri. How do you think you'll handle the fullback spot tomorrow night?
Yeah, not bad, mate. Played there last year in the World Cup, so looking forward to it.
How'd you go in the World Cup?
Yeah, not bad. How do you think I went?
Oh, I think you're all right. From what I've seen, you're all right. You're out after the first two games or three games.
Yeah, that's right. You know, we had a good side, but not as good as yours.
He's my other little rookie, mate. They call him Justin Hodges. He's known as Hodjo or the Rangatang. Rangers, you're on Darren Albert, the quickest man in rugby league. How are you going to stop him? He's not too many words, but with them big long arms, Darren Albert, you want to watch out. That's why they call him the Rangatang. Look how long they are. They're very long. What do you plan to do out there tomorrow night?
Oh, no, I just plan to play a solid game. I've got you outside me, so yeah, the rest takes care of itself.
Yeah, for sure. That's something good to have outside you. Have you been watching Danny Medeiros play?
Yeah, he's been playing well, mate. Hard game tomorrow, but hopefully I'll get the points and you'll get the points over McDougall.
Yeah, plenty of people talking about me and McDougall, and obviously he's a good player, but mate, if I was a paying person in that crowd, I'd like to watch you and Danny Medeiros go at it. You've heard the inside thoughts on the Broncos. Now it's time to go out there and play the Knights and hopefully keep our winning streak. And also the Broncos vice-captain I am. Didn't I?
Yes, he did. Wendell Sailor's vice-captain for Friday night's game against the Knights.
Thank you very much. Long time coming.
Good on you, Wendell. You killed on there, champ. Well done, and congratulations on the vice-captaincy. Also, Adam, though you're still watching, there's a special message for you from Wendell Sailor.
Yeah, I'll be looking forward to playing tomorrow night because if I'm not going to play, well, I'm never going to play because I think I'm on Mad Dog tomorrow night and he's a good player, Mad Dog. And how do you think I'll go on Mad Dog?
I think Mad Dog's got you every time he's played, hasn't he? But, you know, look, a Mad Dog's a bit like you. You both like talking it up, so hopefully you don't talk each other to death out there tomorrow night.
Yeah, well, you know, I hope Mad Dog's out there because last year he stole me football and hasn't brought it back yet. I think he went 80 metres with it, so Mad Dog had locked me football back. Remember that?
Yes, I do.
I wasn't very embarrassed.
You should have been.
I am, trust me.
Adam, your younger brother Ben's playing this weekend, his first grade match with the Northern Eagles. A bit of rivalry there?
No, I'm just happy for him to get a start. I played a number of first grade games with him last year at the Knights and made my mum and dad very proud to see us playing together. And, you know, I'm just happy for him to get a start down at the Eagles, and they're going well this year, and I'm sure he'll go well. So best of luck to him this Sunday.
Well, sure. Darren, you must be enjoying all this talk about the other wingers. No pressure on you going into this one, and I must say your form is absolutely outstanding. A long winning sequence for the Broncos up there. I think they've won their last 16, but I guess you're not even thinking about that. New game, ready to go.
Yeah, that's right. The start of the year for me has been a bit of a bonus. I don't think I've strung this many games together without actually getting an injury, so it's a good bonus for me. But you know, coming into this game, we've had a lot of changes to our side as compared to last year, so we can't really compare history's losses to this game coming up tomorrow night. So we're looking for a big game, and hopefully we can get over top of them.
How important was last week's win over Parramatta coming in a week later against Brisbane?
Yeah, well, I think, out of these first six games, we weren't really tipped to win that many of them, so it's a good bonus for us to get the three, or a draw and two wins. So, it was a big bonus for us, especially the fact that Parramatta have been going so well and they were actually in front of us on the ladder coming into last week's game. So, coming up against Brisbane, we're looking forward to it, and it should be a big clash.
Now, Albie, Joey Johns has had a virus. He's had a bug in his stomach for most of the week. Is he okay?
Yeah, mate, he's fine. He's 100%. He's he didn't come to train for the first few days, but he's back there and training as hard as ever.
Robbie O'Davis, I was going to say, Robbie O'Davis has been playing fantastic. He's on top of the Dally M Awards, and since he's come back, he's had a couple of years off with the foot injury. He's been playing fantastic. But also, boys, what about Justin Ryder? Adam, since you've been out, he's come in and taken his spot. He's really made the most of it. He'll be back. He's a great player, isn't he?
Yeah, champion little guy. And, it's really good for the club when you see the young guys come through. It's, I suppose it's a big compliment to the guys like Albie and all the other senior players in the club to see young guys come through. It obviously shows that they're spending time with the younger players and it's paying off. So, champion kid, can hold his head high. He's played tremendously well for the club. And hopefully I can live up to the big shoes he left me to fill this weekend.
Speaking of big shoes, Chief, there was some talk, I suppose, early in the season about how the Newcastle forwards would handle this year after losing the big men yourself, like Butterfield and that. What have you made of the front six?
Well, I think they've done a fantastic job, the Knights forwards, because also this year, the Knights have got the ability to hang in there. Like, we haven't come from behind in a match in the second half for a long time. We've done it against Canterbury, and it's because the forwards are so consistent. I think the interchange has suited some teams and not the others. I think we've done pretty good there. We've got a smaller pack, more agile. And I can't give Glenn Grief and Clinton O'Brien a big enough rap.
And Steve Simpson's been going good.
Well, he's a great young talent. You know, and Ben Kennedy, all the boys. But Billy Peden, he's the club captain. He's going well too. But
I think they've been fantastic. The win over Parramatta last week was just top-notch.
All right, now, just before we go, Adam, anything special on your, something written on your wrist or pumping the thighs, talking to your thighs tomorrow night?
Well, mate, mate, I don't know about that. Put the pair of footy boots on tonight for the first time all year and my feet are absolutely killing me. So
you'll sleep in them tonight, Diggs.
Yeah, I'll have to sleep in them. Matty John's taught me that trick, so hopefully talk to the boots tomorrow and hopefully they'll fit me by tomorrow. But no, just looking forward to the game. Should be a good one, so hopefully everyone tunes in.
Will be. Darren, yeah, well, boys. Darren, Adam, thanks very much for your time. Boys up there, well done.
Thanks, guys. Thanks.
That will be one hell of a clash up there. The Brisbane Broncos take on the Newcastle Knights. It'll be an absolute beauty up there in ANZ Stadium.
We should point out that'll be live in Sydney with the time difference as well. So basically starting, live everywhere.
That's right. Starting at 7:30 in
Brisbane. What do you reckon, boys? Who's going to win?
Oh, I still favour Brisbane just. Justin, we're pretty tight.
I've tipped Newcastle, and I think the thing that swayed me was the performance last week, and no Darren Lockyer tomorrow night.
Jane, what do you think?
I think the Knights,
good
definitely.
Good on you. Good on you.
Okay, post-try celebrations, they are starting to happen. Good on you, boys, out there, and we've got a good one last week, Pete. Yeah, it's been a slow start to the season, but we're expecting big things in the next couple of weeks. Tamana Tahu has scored the first try last Friday night, and what a talent this kid is. Got 20 tries as their leading try scorer last year, and he started off in similar vein this year. He just shows his basketball skills here for a post-try celebration over to the goalposts. It'd take me a stepladder to get up that high, so he just rolls it over the top. Now, speaking of good starts to the season, as we look at Tahu from another angle there.
Dalians, which we're covering this year, the Footy Show Awards after round four.
Yeah, Tyron Smith, along with Reece Wester and Robbie O'Davis, all on 6 points, just in front of Joey Johns, Nathan Fee and Jason Croker, who was outstanding in a Booten side last weekend, and Preston Campbell doing some good things at the back for the Sharks.
And in Brisbane tonight, the stats really are against Newcastle.
Yes, the Brisbane Broncos haven't lost at home at ANZ Stadium since round 23 back in 1999. Now, the Knights, conversely, haven't won there in three starts to ANZ Stadium, but records, as Michael Hagan suggests, are made to be broken. Now, the Knights had their usual game day warm-up today with a game of cricket near the team's hotel. According to coach Michael Hagan, the secret to beating Brisbane is up front.
Oh, man, I think their forward pack is where it's at. And if you look at the form of Webke and Sivanaseva and Talis, that's probably where the dangers lie. And I think even Pritis at dummy half, he's in pretty good form for them at the moment.
Mick Hagan there. OK, Tony, thanks for all that.
In rugby league, the Broncos and Newcastle meet in Brisbane tonight for what's shaping as one of the best games of the season so far. Darren Lockyer is missing from the home side while Adam McDougall returns for the Knights. But the Broncos still hold a strong psychological advantage.
Despite packing many of the comforts of home,
I've got a bag for my soap and my shampoo.
It's never been a pleasant trip north for the Knights. Since entering the competition more than 12 years ago, Newcastle has never beaten Brisbane at home.
Statistics like that are made to be broken, so, you know, hopefully we can get one away.
For Newcastle to have any chance this evening, Andrew Johns will once again need to take control. Earlier in the week, the Knights captain had trouble just walking. But now he's fully recovered from a stomach bug.
I don't know whether it was something like drunk or ate over the weekend. It's probably more something like drunk, but...
If Johns can help engineer an historic win, there'll be plenty more of that straight after the game.
A rugby league blockbuster kicks off round five of the NRL tonight. Newcastle chases its first ever win at ANZ Stadium against Premiers Brisbane. The clash sets up one of the great personal battles of the season. Wendell Saylor up against Adam McDougall.
It's the showdown that should ensure a bumper crowd at ANZ Stadium, and McDougall is back in the Knights' armour, having been sidelined since breaking a thumb in the World Cup.
Yeah, just excited, mate. Been a long time since I've played, so just really keen to get out there and just enjoy myself.
A lack of match practice could be Mad Dog's only problem.
He's probably got a bit of an advantage over me. I haven't played all year and very much underdone, so if he's going to get me, it's a good chance for him to get me now.
But Wendell isn't buying into any of that pre-game talk.
No, not at all. I think he's a prize horse and he just saved himself for the big games and the big races.
And Saylor remembers all too well this effort when McDougall didn't make him look so good in a clash last year.
McDougall takes the ball off him!
You know, he's a pretty special player and I've just got to make sure that he doesn't reef that ball off me like I'm a little kid again, because I'm still embarrassed about that.
For Wendell and the Broncos, they're going for 17 straight wins at home. They hope their 17th is luckier for them than our cricketers. Brisbane will be without fullback Darren Lockyer for this blockbuster that kicks off round five.
Yeah, playing against Brisbane and playing against Wendell up at ANZ, it's always a good challenge, so I have to be on my game and just mentally be ready to go.
Do you agree that it's the battle for the number one wing spot in the world?
Oh, well, I'd like to think so, but in saying that, he's probably got a bit of an advantage over me. I haven't played all year and very much underdone, so if he's going to get me, it's a good chance for him to get me now.
Yeah, I've got a lot of respect for Mad Dog. You know, we played a couple of good games. I think the last game he got over me at ANZ, I was a bit embarrassed that night. He's just physically, I think he's probably the strongest player I've played against. And just he's got a lot of skills. And I think last year, I was going all right in the first half. The second half I came out and I thought I had the wood on him. And all I remember, 20 metres out from our line, I was running and I thought I could throw him off. And he ripped the ball out. And all I could do was look and watch him go about 80 metres up the field. And, you know, Joey Johns is a good mate of mine, looked at me and just gave me the nod and started laughing at me, and I was just embarrassed then. And then to make matters worse, 10 minutes later, they put a cross kick over and I hadn't been out and jumped for a couple of years now, and he's out jumped me and there was two tries on me and I couldn't do much. But Mad Dog hasn't let me forget it, but it's just, honestly, I respect him and I love playing against him, and I think this is what rugby league's all about.
Two wingers going head to head in just a matter of moments at ANZ Stadium. Locker, they can talk it up now, those wingers.
I can't believe that wingers make the headlines these days, Roy. It used to be the forwards bashing each other, but now the wingers are getting all the girls and the publicity.
What did you used to do at Balmain Leagues Club with the wingers and somebody
send them to get the drinks? They wouldn't wear their hair. Go and hurry up.
You know why wingers score tries, don't you? Because they're marked by other wingers.
Exactly right. Well, the Knights, they do have McDougall back, and they are still the underdogs up there at ANZ Stadium. In fact, their record against Brisbane isn't fantastic at ANZ. The referee is Bill Harrigan. Friday night, Bill, and Brisbane are the short $1.45. Newcastle getting 7.5 start. I think they're a chance, MG.
You'd have to have a piece of that. I mean, it's a pretty big start to give, and I mean, any team with Joey Johns in it, you can't discount.
They're a little bit flat last week, the Brisbane Broncos, although they got away with the Tigers quite comfortably. They would have been revving themselves up for this game. I think they'll
Mark Hughes is the bloke who's really impressed me this year. I suppose he's been doing the same thing for a few years, but he's really stepped up to the plate, Mark Hughes, since Gidley's been out.
Scotty Prince is back to the bench. Sean Berrigan has made the starting 13 as a halfback. Willie, Berrigan is tenacious, isn't he?
Yeah, I watched the game last week when they played, and he played an excellent game. You know, for Scott Prince, he'll have to come off the bench now, but he's a great player as well. So they got, you know, good choices there.
Yeah, Lockyer. Justin Hodges is. Lockyer.
Yeah, Lockyer's a loss. You know, the tactical kicking there to sort of try and match up with the Johns in that area. When we still don't know, even an hour before kickoff, would we, with McDougall's going
to
play?
He's expected to play. He wants to get out there against Wendell and prove a point. Well, it's a strange feeling for Andrew Johns tonight. He came close to wearing a Broncos jumper before re-signing with the Knights.
Probably would have been a weird situation playing against the boys. And you know, at the end of the day, I was a Newcastle boy, or Cessna boy. I was never going to leave this area, so... You know, I'm really proud of the way the boys are going. We got written off this year, and we're going to prove everyone wrong. So, you know, still everyone's not wrapping us, so it suits us. We go along slowly, but I'm sure come September we'll be there.
You know, we spoke about a number of teams in the first 6 weeks that would be difficult to perform against, and Brisbane are certainly on the top of the list. I think if you look at the percentages, they're the third best attacking and defensive team, and we're ranked fourth in attack and defence. So just from that alone, it would be fair to say it's going to be a pretty good contest between two good football teams.
I'm happy with where we're at. I know where we're at, and they know where they're at now, and they know what they've got to improve on and be better at. And tomorrow night just gives you that chance to put yourself under that type of pressure out there to find out, you know, how far you're off it again, and just keep working until you get it right.
Word from Brisbane is that Wayne Bennett, Roy, sat Wendell down and said it's okay. You've got the rah-rah contract, but you're talking a lot, but you're not performing like he did last year, so expect a very big game from Wendell.
Yeah, I think so. He'll relish the opportunity. He'll take the challenge and he'll play very well tonight.
They're the two best strike players in the NRL today.
Then the jump is on out wide, and what a magnificent take by Wendell. He starts his run down the park. What's the betting? Two's on Sailor. They're after him, but they're not making any impression. So from Johns, across to McDougall again, 360 degrees, back up the middle goes McDougall, he's over!
Sailor of the Broncos, McDougall of the Knights. Each packing 100 kilos plus of playing power. When they clash, it's personal.
Here comes Wendell, running into Adam McDougall. McDougall takes the ball off him! There's a foot race on! McDougall by 2 metres! McDougall's got 10 to go! McDougall goes in!
An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth.
Kamali unloads the ball out the back. Now McDougall. Well, tremendous effort by Wendell Saylor to shut him down.
Tonight, the deal resumes when Brisbane takes on Newcastle on Nine's Wide World of Sports.
Rugby league and winning streaks are hard to create, but losing streaks are sometimes harder to break. Newcastle discovered that last night, continuing a dismal record against the Broncos at ANZ Stadium.
Over the years, some magnificent teams have travelled from the Steel City to Brisbane, but none have walked off ANZ Stadium victorious.
I haven't had much fun here in Brisbane as a player or a coach, so it looks like I've got to leave it another year to see if we can get some joy.
It was an encouraging start for the Knights, spreading the ball wide after just 2 minutes.
They've got Takiri on his own out there. Albert's over.
But before long, the Broncos' bruising defence was claiming casualties, forcing the Knights into early rotations. Then the Premiers confirmed their credentials in attack.
Back to Sivanaseva. He puts it over the line. It's a try. It's a try.
The battle between internationals Wendell Saylor and Adam McDougall headlined the match, and the pair didn't disappoint.
Now McDougall lines Saylor up and hits him equally hard.
Brisbane gained the upper hand before the break thanks to Lottie Takiri. The Knights taking out their frustration from the restart.
Hodges, oh!
Then the turning point in the game with a freakish all-the-way effort by Chris Walker.
Here's a break being made by Brisbane down the right side. And Walker is it. He's made it. He's gone all the way.
The floodgates had opened, Hodges chiming in for a double to sink Newcastle's hopes. Then more frustration, this time from Clinton O'Brien. But the Knights were being hurt on the scoreboard, Scott Prince capping off the record win.
Until they consistently, you know, can produce an effort like they did tonight. Been inconsistent for 4 weeks, you know, we got one right. So that's what they've got to learn to do.
We're going to have to regroup for the next week in terms of injuries and just how we recover to go to Melbourne.
A walkover in the end, 42 points to 8, Brisbane's 18th unbeaten match in a row at home.
A black weekend for the NRL with 8 players to face the judiciary on various charges. 3 of them are from the Dragons. But the biggest name of all is the Broncos' Gordon Tallis, cited this afternoon when new video evidence was produced of his tackle on Newcastle's Steve Simpson. In the lead-up to the incident, forwards Glenn Grief and Clinton O'Brien were hammered, but it was Steve Simpson who came off worst against Tallis. He was lifted, then driven into the ground and hit near the eye by the Bronco forward's elbow. Simpson was concussed and later received 9 stitches. Today, he stated the obvious.
I think it was an elbow or something like that, but yeah, he didn't miss me.
In Brisbane, Tallis found out about the sighting just before training. He and coach Wayne Bennett appeared surprised by the charge.
I'm going to muck around the Knights to 2 very special guest hosts. Please make them welcome Andrew Johns and Ryan Girdler. Welcome, boys. It's great news to have two of the best players in the NRL on our show. Welcome, boys. Andrew, Ryan.
Thank you, guys.
Good to see you. Joey, we haven't forgotten you. Joey, Newcastle last week really got hammered at the end of the Broncos.
Yeah, we're not pretty confident, actually, after we beat Parramatta, but just, you know, it was like men playing boys. I just, you know, really big and strong. But, you know, we had got a few injuries early.
Well, you did early. I mean, you had half a side by the end of it.
Yeah, you know, at this stage, I really thought, you know, it's going to be quite a game. But, you know, there is a great side. And a few areas where we had to sort of muscle up and be strong, we didn't probably. And played, you know.
Andrew, I know you're not one for excuses. I think I used the word on your performance as subdued. Were you 100% going into this game?
I was a bit down. I was a bit crooked during the week. But, yeah, come to the game, I felt all right. So, yeah, it's just one of those things. I'll be able to have a big one this week, probably put that one away.
You've played against the Broncos plenty of times over the years. Have you seen them in that sort of form?
Yeah, quite a few times, actually. They beat us by 40 a few times. Yeah. So, yeah, top quite a few times. But they were quite awesome. And there's no excuses, but, yeah, we'll get them again.
All right, OK. Now, why the crowd is laughing is our next guest is actually on the big screen here. We're about to go to him right now. all the way from England, England, please make him welcome Andrew's brother, Matthew. Hello, Matt. So, Matty, how's the weather? Looking good there?
Oh, it's fantastic. Welcome. Welcome. Actually, I'm wearing this coat. I decided to show off a little bit. I had a stopover on the way at Vancouver with the family, and I decided to kill a bear with my own fists. And, I mean, you just can't buy quality. You cannot buy quality like this. Just have a look at the inside. Do you want to have a feel of this? That's magic.
I was actually going to ask you, Matthew, whether Trish, your wife, minded you wearing her clothes. That was all, but yeah, that's not the case.
Yeah, they got the underpants on, but that's about all.
Yeah, Matty, it's Joe here. How you going, mate? Yeah?
Hey, mate, how you doing?
Your brother.
You've lost no weight off that backside.
Yeah, mate, I was wondering, is Wigan the same as Newcastle? Have you got the halfback there doing all the tackling for you?
Oh, yeah, of course. Poor old Lammy, he's got a bit crooked back at the moment for carrying me, but... I'm enjoying it here, actually, Joey. It's good. Fantastic stadium, as you can see here. All-seater stadium and good facilities. Teammates are good. Having a good time.
Yeah, Matty Gertz, mate. How you doing?
Gertz, you're a machine. What are you doing?
Good, mate. That's my only cry. I just want to see you. I haven't spoken in a while. Things are going well.
Matty, just tell us how many Australians are playing in the Wigan side at the moment.
Well, we've got myself, Steve Renoff, David Ferner, Adrian Lamb, and Brett Dallas. So there's five of us here. I suppose you can class Lamb as an Australian, although he hails from Papua New Guinea, that little place up the top there. So, but yeah, we've got a good Aussie contingent. It's really good. Good team spirit here. The standard of the football is very good at the moment. Over the last couple of years with the summer rugby, a byproduct of that has been that the standard and the skill level of the players has shot up here. And I can say that, you know, I think this Ashes series coming up at the end of the year with Great Britain, it'll be a cracker.
Yeah, we look forward to another kangaroo tour, Matty, but there are some injury worries over there. I know you're missing tomorrow night's game against Leeds and plenty of that other Australians over there carrying some injuries, mostly hamstring problems. Why is that? Just age, or you don't stretch anymore? Or?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure what it is. All the cattle over here is getting foot and mouth, and all the Australians are getting hamstring injuries. But, I think it's from the. I think it's from the heavy tracks and the cold weather. I'm not exactly sure, but I'm very close to 100%. But with my history of hamstrings, you know, until you're 110% right, you know, you just don't risk them, particularly in this sort of weather.
Yeah, man, I've actually thought of a question, mate. It's Joey was saying that you've moved into Dave Beckham's house. Mate, you enjoy living there? What's happening? Fill us in about, tell us a little bit about that house.
Oh, yeah, I'm just living with Bex and Posh at the moment. They're nice people. You know, I'm just sort of... But I'm going over to have dinner tonight with Charles.
Actually, so, Matty, you know how you... We had Craig...
But there's no truth...
You know how we had Craig Johnson on and you did the sting on him? Well, it's just happened. It's just happened to Ryan. Ryan's got no idea that you're not living anywhere where David Beckham once lived, but he has believed that for the last hour and a half.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah, that's Penrith Blake, so just a little bit slow. I don't know what it is.
So, Matt, you've been hanging around during the week with plenty of Aussies. What have you been doing when you're not playing footy and training?
Well, I tell you what, Fatty, I've been, as I said, it's a good team spirit here. The players mix well. I went into, going to Manchester and Liverpool and doing a little bit of travelling. I went to Paris. It was really good, you know. So getting to see plenty of the world. Walked around Paris, actually. Couldn't speak French. I could only say merci and bonjour. That was about it. So I was the dummy of France for that weekend. But I'm really enjoying it, mate. It's good.
All right, Matt. Well, listen, I hope you get back on the field soon. Anything... Last from you, Andrew, to your brother?
No, mate, I'll give you a call probably tonight, reverse charges.
Yeah, well, that's right. Yeah, I can imagine. The big news over here, there's big news over here at the moment, actually. There's whispers that every day that the Rugby Union and the Rugby League are getting closer and closer together. There's further whispers that the top 12 Rugby Union clubs have sort of in dispute with the rugby union and itself, the RFU, and are looking to move away. And coincidentally, a few of the top rugby league clubs over here are looking to field rugby union sides. So, you know, who knows?
Yeah, thanks for that, mate.
That's terrific. Good job. Thanks, Matty Jones.
Hey, I tried it first.
Matthew Jones there, now playing for Wigan, one of the greats of the Australian Rugby League. And he's injured at the moment, but he'll actually kill them when he gets back on the field, one of the greats. Thanks to Matt.
Yeah, we've got our Week in League segment coming up, and of course, it all started last Friday night, as we spoke about with Joey, with another win for the Broncos up at ANZ Stadium. 40 points to 8 it finished, yeah, and a big start from the Newcastle Knights. They couldn't go on with it. That was Scott Prince scoring the final one of the night. The only sour note for the Broncos, of course, was their captain, Gordon Tallis, found guilty on a striking charge, and it was on Steve Simpson in that tackle there, and the NRL judiciary found Gordon guilty, and he will spend the next 3 weeks on the sideline.
Show. This is Mastermind. Pete, you just relax over there and enjoy yourself. He's just about on the camera. And look, this is Mastermind. Joey takes on Ryan Girdler, and if they get a question right, they get $100. They get one wrong, they lose $100. And at the end of the night, they're going to donate any money they've made to the local club that you play for as a junior. Is that right?
I don't know, mate.
Yep, you are. All right. Now, you get to phone a friend on this twice each if you need to. And that friend, we're about to ring him right now. Hello, friend.
Fat man.
Who would that be?
It's Freddie.
Brad Fittler, ladies and gentlemen. He's at home. Nice shot, nice photo. Snuggle up in bed with a cup of tea. Is that right, Freddie?
Sure is.
All right, now the boys, I think, will be needing some help. You stay on the line there, and they'll go to you whenever they can. Nice. All right? Thanks, champ.
Thanks, mate.
Brad Fittler there. Now, first question. Ready to go?
Yep.
Nice to see you. Which individual has so far scored the most points in season 2001? Who was that? That way?
Clinton Shikovsky.
Hazam El Masri with 56.
Yeah.
You're down a hunch. Which team won last year's first division premiership?
Canterbury. No.
Canterbury is right. Well done, Joey. Up a hunch. Who am I? Buzz in whenever you think you've got it right. I was born July 31.
I'll let Fred answer that one.
Mate, I'm
going
to
step in
the dark and say Nathan Brown.
Freddie, you're online there? Okay, the clue so far, I was born July 31.
July 31.
Yep, who do you think it is?
I think Nathan Brown was born on July 31.
That's exactly right, you're a genius!
Something's going on here. Something's going on.
Name two other current first grade players who have a colour as their surname.
Other than, like, Brown?
Yes.
Or other than him? Or
other than Nathan Brown. Oh, okay. So it's two others. That'd be two others.
Johnny Blue.
What, that...
I'll give
Nathan
you a clue.
Black? Lock? And Craig Greenhill.
Yeah, we'll take them, I think. Paul Green, Ben Black, but we'll take those blokes. If you're on an ocean liner halfway between New Zealand and Chile at approximately 5:30 p.m. tomorrow, what would you have a good chance of seeing? Yes.
Water.
You're right. Well done. What is the primary language spoken in Chile?
Spanish.
Yes, you're right. You can buzz in, Freddie, anytime you like. If you're in your car and heard the songs Back in Black, Satisfaction.
AC/DC,
yeah.
Rolling Stones.
And Oops, I Did It Again.
Spearsy. What's Spearsy?
Britney Spears, yes, you got it. Well done. Name the two former
representative of the rugby union players, now playing for Penrith and Newcastle.
Freddie,
you online there, champ?
Yeah, who's this for?
This is for Joey.
For Joey, mate.
Dreams for
you
100.
Know we talked about.
The two former representative of rugby union players now playing for Penrith and Newcastle.
Peter Jorgensen for Penrith.
Yeah.
BK.
And B. Kennedy for Newcastle.
Ben Kennedy, yeah. Well done. Who was the first Australian player to become a dual international, having played a rugby league international first?
Yep.
Andrew Walker.
Exactly right. Yeah, one test for Australia Rugby League in 1996. Wallabies in the season 2000. If the Pumper, Raging Bull and the Shark were meeting at the pub, who would be meeting who?
The Pumper's Jimmy Cassidy.
Yep. Raging Bull.
That'd be Gordy.
Unless it's Gordon Lockalupu.
Mark Lockalupu.
Yep.
Yeah, and who was the last one, mate?
Shark.
Greg Norman.
Greg Norman, you got that one, doll? Yes, which team's home ground has the biggest capacity? Joey?
Brisbane.
Yes, with 60,000, that's at ANZ Stadium.
Come on, Gerds.
What family did Chevy Chase make famous for the National Lampoons?
The Griswolds.
The Griswolds, yep.
Oh, I know.
There's some hell going on here.
What was the tourist attraction that was closed when they arrived?
Wally World.
Wally World. What was the daughter's name?
It was Russ and Audrey.
Audrey, yes.
Becca.
And what town can lay claim to being the most eastern in Australia? Yes.
Byron Bay.
Final answer?
Byron Bay.
Is that your final answer?
Yep.
You're right. So there we go.
Thank you, Gerds.
Wizard. I've given $1,000 in Mario segment to the Catherine Bay Hill pub team. And Ryan's made $700, Joey $600. Wizard, fantastic. Thank you very much. Other way around, whatever. $1,300 jumped in from the boys. Thanks to Wizard, thanks to Joey, and thanks to Ryan. And we'll take a break. We're coming back with the Wheel of Death, Cracker Fat. Tonight, please thank the boys for us. Ryan Girdler, right, Andrew Johns, Sneaky Pete, and I'm Paul Gordon. We'll see you next week on the Footy Show. Bye.
Fans, the chief executives, the players, the coaches, everybody looking for some actions and some decisions. Talk about this for a decision. Gordon Tallis angered the judiciary this week with claims they were inconsistent. Well, Gordon found out the hard way, fighting his striking charge and losing. So too the Dragons pair of Lance Thompson and Jason Riles. I thought Gordon was always going to be optimistic, thinking he'd come down here and beat the charge.
Well, I reckon that his QC, Bernie Gross, a great expert in industrial law, is an absolute non-expert in rugby league. I think he goosed himself and put up a very poor defence.
Well, the thing was too, Gordon rides for the Courier Mail, as we used to, and that was one of the things they used on his defence. Something from his own publication, so I'm sure.
Attack and defence, I think it was.
Yeah, that didn't look good, that picture then, with the elbow clenched and coming down on someone's head.
He could have at least said he had his elbow like that because he was looking to break.
Well, he could have said, look at the pimple on the elbow there.
The other thing, too, is what happens on the field stays on the field. That rule is obviously gone now. That was missed by the touch judges and the referee and the video people. And it was given up by the Newcastle.
Well done for Steve Simpson's head there, stopping the fall there of Gordon Tallis. He could have hurt his elbow. Despite the overwhelming evidence, Tallis continued to plead his innocence, but holds no ill feeling towards the Knights after being cited.
No, mate. I thought the worst tackle in the game was the one on Luke Prittis, but they didn't say too much about that.
Gordon, the judiciary boss said that to be found guilty, it had to be considered deliberate or highly reckless. How do you feel about that?
Well, mate, you saw the tackle, didn't you? So, yeah, I mean, I might know that there was no intent in the tackle, you know, and I'm confident about that, and I know that, you know, that I can walk out of here knowing that I didn't, you know, I deliberately, you know, go there to hurt the bloke.
There's probably an issue from a media point of view trying to generate some ill feeling between the clubs, but that's certainly not the case from our point of view. And if it means that we protect our players by lodging a report through the correct channels, I don't see why there should be a problem in that sense. And Edwards basically admitted that, and Gordon Tallis, I think, would even consider that he would have a case to answer given the evidence that was brought before the league. So that would have happened irrespective of our report that we put in, but there were certainly some high shots in the game that we wanted them to have a look at. And under the new rules, the reason for that was because of the fact that we had four players with cuts to the head and another player all but concussed. So any coach worth his salt would want to look at some of those things to see if there was anything untoward in all of that. So I really don't. And if it's the Roosters or the Northern Eagles, I'd be doing exactly the same thing next week.
Yeah, Michael Hagan there speaking out in defence of the Newcastle Knights. Of course, Brisbane are saying they never cite anybody, they never make any complaints to the judiciary after a game. Well, that's simply rubbish because everybody's there to protect their own players. And through different channels, they always tend to make a complaint.
And I find it ironic too. I'd like to see a statistic on teams that get beat lodging complaints. Not many teams who win and their players are injured lodge complaints, but it always seems to be a losing team.
They didn't just get beaten either, they got
hammered. Well, that's what I mean. It just seems to be that the teams that get beaten or on the wrong end of the scoring sheet seem to always lodge the complaints. But, you know, if you win a game by 30 points, you don't really worry about it, do you?
Yeah, but all clubs do it.
An amazing thing, Ted, that winning teams don't seem to have as many injuries as
losing. No, exactly.
That's right. Exactly.
And the other headaches, but off on Monday.
The other point about Newcastle too, they used to be the givers. Now they are receiving a little
big
bit.
Sarge and the boys.
Four other players were cited after round five matches. Newcastle's Clinton O'Brien, the worst offender. Gordon Tallis pointed that out, but the bloke did cop 4 weeks, so the worst tackle of the game was punished the most severe of the weekend.
Do you reckon we should bring in some sort of consistency with if you get hit flush on the chin with a high tackle, doesn't come off the shoulder or the ball or whatever, it should be an automatic suspension?
It's a hard one. The Storm are back at Colonial Stadium for their clash with Newcastle. This game, 2 p.m. on Sunday. Both clubs are coming off losses.
They got hammered.
They did. That's why I'm tipping Newcastle.
I'm going to go for the Storm, I think. I think that Marcus Bye, you know, I mean, really, he's a piece of seventh forward, Marcus Bye. I think he'll just give them an extra little bit of sting there. It's silly to say that a bloody winger's going to make the difference, but I've just said it.
He wasn't real happy last week, Coach Chris Anderson. At half-time, when they come back onto the field to play the Tigers, their whole back row, Rua, Kearney and Hill, he put them on the bench.
One thing for sure, Matty and Marcus Bye will be getting the drinks after the game block if they... That's your rules. Wingers get drinks. So straight back in the team, give me a bourbon.
Justin Ryder, of course, he comes into the side. Robbie O'Davis has pulled out with a hamstring injury. And Josh Perry, he's only 19 or 20. He's about 110 kgs, runs like the wind. Matt Parsons also starting. So it's a big front row, but a different looking front row.
I was so disappointed with them last week. I was very excited about that Friday night game. Yeah. Newcastle up the Brisbane Broncos. Finally someone to challenge them, and it just didn't happen.
I think Ryder will play on the wing there, and McDougall will go back to fullback where he filled in so well last year.
Yeah, just having the mad dog in the team there on chance, and number seven there, A. John's, I regard as the best player in the world. I think while ever he's in the team, there's always a chance.
Did you see in the press this week that some corners of the press already that have never played a game themselves are putting pressure on Johns now, saying who will be in the State of Origin side of that? I mean, he's the best player in the world.
Yeah. No doubt about that. Newcastle are still smarting after that 42-8 loss to Brisbane, as Blocker mentioned, and are looking for revenge against the Storm.
Yeah, it was a slow start to the season. I was struggling the first couple of weeks, but I think I've been playing the minutes, and I'm working towards getting a start. It's unfortunate it had to come this way, but you know, I would like to think that I could have forced my way into the team at some stage. So yeah, I think my fitness is going pretty good, and it's all improving.
Matt Parsons there, who will line up with in the front row for the Newcastle Knights.
The Melbourne Storm have followed last week's big loss with another less than impressive show, this time against Newcastle at Colonial Stadium. The Knights running in 5 tries to blot in the first half.
He went straight past Matt Geyer, flicked it back to Justin Ryder. The Knight Ryder is in again.
A much better performance from the Storm in the second half, an Aaron Mule try bringing them to within 8 points. And more talk today that Melbourne coach Chris Anderson will be leaving the club. The final score there, Newcastle 36, Melbourne Storm 28.
At Colonial Stadium, Melbourne and Newcastle produced an 11-try feast. The Storm fighting back when it appeared the Knights were heading for a landslide victory.
Humbled last weekend, Melbourne's nightmare run continued against Newcastle.
The Knight Rider is in again.
Exploiting the Storm's compressed defence, the invading Knights were in a rampant mood, leading 30-0 by half-time.
Albert steps past Mike Marcus Bye.
Remarkably, Melbourne crossed 5 times in the second half.
He will
But the Storm ran out of time, losing by just 8 points.
In Melbourne, the Knights tried to blast the Storm off the park with a stunning opener. Five soft first half tries, giving them a 30-0 lead. The Storm came home hard, but it was too little too late. Patrick Mullahan, 7 News.
Andrew Johns here. We've had a few sporting products. We've had Warney's spinning ball. We've had Chuck Halligan's kicking tee. The new product that I'm sure every kid will like to have, it's the Andrew Johns Kick Wizard. And we've got some kids here from Merriweather Public School. We're going to try it out. So we'll get out there and nail some torpedo bombs, eh? Let's go. Come on. Very good. It does work. Right, here's the ball. And it's fairly simple once you look at it and read the instructions, and just shows you where to put the ball, your hand, your right hand, and places to hit the ball. It's a bit of fun. The kids here are having obviously a lot of fun with it, and they're actually picking they're nailing a few torpedoes. So I think anything keeps kids interested in football is something good. So hopefully I'll get out there and buy it. I've been with the kids now for about half an hour, and already a couple of them are potting a few 40-20s. So it's a great ball, and he's all enjoyed it?
Yes!
Really good?
Yes!
So what do you want for Easter?
One of these.
Here we go, watch this. Bang! See you later.
Oh, yeah!
Good on you, Joey. The Kicking Wizard. And yes, it's a good product. Go out and buy it. Joey sold it very well.
I'm going to buy one.
Yeah,
I'm going to
buy one for
Hannah.
What are you going to buy one for?
I'm going to buy one for myself. Excellent. And for Hannah, and you'll get one for
I'll
Maddie.
I'll buy one for Maddie.
Johns, you're right here, mate. 18 years' time. Go you, good night.
Newcastle and the Warriors, they clash at Marathon tomorrow at 5:30. A big day for Clinton Newton, the son of golfing legend Jack. And Newton comes in for the injured Ben Donaldson. So no doubt that Jack Newton is the most one-eyed Newcastle supporter going around, and his son will make his first grade debut off the bench there. Clint, he's a good young kid. We've seen him a fair bit go around in first division. And Mark Hughes goes back to fullback. There's no Robbie O'Davis. Justin Ryder will play on the other wing, and Adam McDougall moves into the centres, and Michael Hagan doing a great job.
Sorry, it made me laugh. Where does Clint Newton play? Is he hooker?
Second row. He's a back row, isn't he? Yep. Be interesting to see how he goes.
And Jay Morgan's been in pretty good form for Auckland, and he comes in, so Stacey Jones also outstanding. They'd be pretty cock-a-hook after their win last week against Brisbane.
Yeah, Daniel Anderson, he's sort of come from nowhere. He's done a terrific job. I mean,
that's what they needed, I think.
For a structure there.
For a period of time, no one thought they were going to have a team. Then they lost some players, and he's got over there late, and they had a late start to their pre-season, but he's done a terrific job.
Their biggest problem is the same as nearly everyone else in the league, consistency. They played enormously well last week. Who were the yardstick? Brisbane Broncos. If they can put it back-to-back, then we'll start talking about them a bit more.
Yeah, away from home, that's the big test for them, like North Queensland. If they start winning away from home, you start to take them a bit more seriously. But at the moment,
they are bigger, aren't they? I mean, man on man, and their pack seems to be getting through a lot more work. And I thought the limited interchange would really hurt them, but they're thriving under it.
Yeah, they're going well. As you said, Anderson's obviously a very good coach, but I think the addition of Kevin Campion in the team... Yeah. That's probably helped them out more than anything else.
I watched him last week too, Campion. It would have been very easy for him to leave the Brisbane Broncos. He went to England, then come back and just hover around. The first five tackles in that game he made from marker. I mean, it was just an unbelievable effort, and he's putting his hand up every week.
I think they need to get a good mix of maybe Aussies and Kiwis. When they first started, they wanted bases the whole sort of Kiwi side, I think, but they need a good mixture, I think, to get everything.
Yeah, about 12 Aussies and one Kiwi.
Oh, no.
Is that about...
Nah.
But no, they're like Guttenbeel, they can play Guttenbeel, and they're good players.
And that Ali Latidi, he's a good player too, but you just need a good...
See it?
You need a good mixture to get a good balance right, you know?
We mentioned young Clint Newton. He's big, he's strong, and he's eager to impress in his first grade debut.
Bit of a surprise, but I'm just looking at getting out there and just having a go and trying to help the boys in their quest to win the game, pretty much.
Is it a bit of a blessing in disguise that you sort of got short notice because you can just get out there and not think about it too much?
I think so. Most of the boys have sort of been pretty good. I've spoken to a couple of them already, and they just said, look, you just got to do your best and go out there, and that's all pretty much you can do, and that's all Michael sort of asked of you.
Speaking about the development program for the Brisbane Broncos, Newcastle also have a great nursery up there to choose from, and Clint Newton coming through that nursery.
Newcastle hosted the New Zealand Warriors at Marathon Stadium. Led by an inspirational Andrew Johns, the home side bolted to a 33-8 lead. The Warriors looked gone, but in almost a repeat of last week, the Knights faded in the second half. The visitors put on three tries to be back in the match.
Went away from Nathan Wood, he picks it up, and they will score! Oh, what a try!
But then this Andrew Johns try, his third for the match, shut the door on the Warriors' comeback. Newcastle winners 45-24.
Well, we just had one of them games, I guess. That you know, it's probably our first, I'd say, real poor performance. You know, we were just off the ball tonight, totally. Once we start slow, and then we just proceeded to slacken right off, unfortunately, and the Knights punished us.
I would have to give some credit to Auckland. I think they've got a lot of strike power, a lot of pace, they've got a lot of footwork, a lot of speed. So a couple of the tries they scored I thought were pretty impressive tries. To defend against them is quite difficult.
Earlier in the night, New Zealand crossed first against Newcastle at Marathon Stadium.
Dummy half and reach out and score a very soft try.
But Andrew John showed very early on that it was going to be one of his games. Mark Hughes capitalised on Rudder's break and the Knights were charging.
He couldn't pick him up. The pass back on the inside to Mark Hughes. They are in for number two.
The Johns army at Marathon were again on their feet a few minutes later when the little master did it all himself.
Johns off the left foot, looking for the line himself. Oh, that was too easy.
Andrew capping off a great first half with a one-pointer. Adam McDougall was the first to make his mark in the second stanza to take the score to 27 points to 8. No need for Ben Kennedy to expend anywhere near as much energy for this try.
Crashes across to score.
To their credit, the Warriors didn't lay down their weapons.
Attacking line is Lauatiti. Drops it back for Nathan Wood. Straight through a gap. Steps in behind Andrew Johns. Lobs a pass over the top. Torpy gets there to score his second.
But too little too late, Andrew Johns crossing for his third.
For number three.
Newcastle convincing winners, 45 points to 24. Andrew Johns breaking his own club record with 29 points.
Yeah, good on Joe. Also, Parramatta had a great win last night, and their captain joins us right now, Jason Taylor. Welcome, Jason. Hey, champ.
Nathan Kalis is the captain of the side.
Yeah. Oh, captain, vice captain.
Yeah,
what do you think of? I'm just watching Andrew Johns there. What do you got a rap on him?
There's no doubt. He sets the standard in the halfback position, as far as I'm concerned, has done for a number of years.
He could be the best we've seen ever, the best halfback ever.
Well, he's so strong, isn't he? And defensively, he's just as good as a front rower. He's got all the skills, and he's playing behind a very good side, Andrew Johns. And Kamali, on the other hand, is playing behind a side that's not going that well.
Interesting you say he's the best halfback ever, or could be the best halfback ever, and 7 out of 10 people would probably say he's the best player in the world right at this particular time. He can't play halfback for his state or his country. I mean, it's an amazing set of circumstances.
Do you think that'll change? Will that change?
It's got to change. He's got to be the number 7 for New South Wales. He just has to be. And that's taking nothing away from Brett Kamali, and I've said this from day one. Representative football is a reward for your performance. It's a reward. Mm. It's a recognition of the type of player you are. It's
yeah, Gus, but I'm not saying he's not going to. He won't be a halfback. But you've got to pick the best team. You don't just pick.
No,
teams
representative footballers pick the best players. You're not going to pick a bad team at rep football.
But it's about picking the best team.
No, the best hooker deserves to play rep football, not the best halfback playing hooker, nor the best.
All right.
Of course, Billy Peden, he joins us live from Newcastle.
Like Warren Ryan and you know, even the hooker they had up there, English hooker Lee Jackson, they got him out. We'll talk to Billy later about that. But yeah. I think the players genuinely like Chris Anderson. And, I mean, he's an Australian coach. He must have a lot of wisdom as well. The trouble with Warren Ryan when he was there was just a straight shooter. I mean, he told you things a lot of times you didn't like to hear.
But he still told you.
And players didn't cop it too well.
Next up on NRL Winners, Billy Peden live from Newcastle. Our next guest, well, he started playing rugby league as soon as he could walk in the tough areas around Newcastle. In fact, Cessnock, and Billy Peden now joins us live from our Newcastle studios. Firstly, Billy, Billy, welcome, mate.
Yeah, thanks a lot, guys. How's it going?
Mate, good, buddy.
What about you? You didn't make your debut until you were 24 years of age for the Newcastle Knights, but you were playing football, as I mentioned, throughout your entire childhood. Slow starter, mate?
Yeah, pretty much. It took me a long time to grow and catch up to the other blokes. In fact, I'm probably still trying to catch up to them in the growth stakes. But, yeah, I was just unlucky probably early on and then very fortunate to, at the end there to, at 24, get the opportunity to play in the NRL. It was tremendous.
Plenty of ironies this weekend for you. You're going down to Bruce Stadium, of course, the Canberra Raiders. But Robert Finch was the man who got you out of Cessnock and had a good look at you.
Yeah, I think Finchie was the man that really got me on board at Newcastle, and probably through the arm twisting of Matty Johns, he kept saying his mate from Cessnock wasn't a bad player to get him a run. So probably also along with Steve Fulmer. So you know, those guys really helped me along my way, and you know, I'm very thankful for what they've done for me.
Billy, it's MG here, mate. How you going?
Good, MG.
That's good, mate. I'm just curious on the different strategies. You know, Hagan compared to Reilly, and then Warren Ryan. What's been the main change or differences in them three techniques?
Yeah, obviously they're all very different. Wok had his ideas, and Mal had his, and you know, it's pretty easy to see how we played under those guys. But Hagan has probably got a few different areas he likes working on. You know, he's also very good with his defence, but you know, he's good with his attack as well. And when he gets sort of into the brains trust with Andrew Johns, he really sort of gets it going, and you know, he's been tremendous.
We've just seen some vision here of using the pool. What about Clinton O'Brien? Put some beef on.
Yeah, Clint's been a little bit unlucky with that suspension the last month or so, but before that he was going great guns.
Yeah, great man, great player.
Billy, you've been around the club a fair while now. Well, you've lost some great players up front, and I know that you would have appreciated them even when they were playing. You know, blokes like Butts and the Chief and so forth, but still around that Newcastle area, always some great talent coming through. Young Perry has really impressed me, and also Stimp Simpson.
Yeah, they're great players. Young Josh is really playing great guns for us, and Steve Simpson, he's been going great for probably 2 years and just starting to get a bit of recognition now. So, you know, it's a great nursery, and like you say, to lose blokes like Buttsy and Chief and even blokes like Dave Fairley, even though we only had him for 12 months, he was a revelation while he was here. So, you know, to lose those guys, I suppose the size, but mainly the experience, was a testing time for us, and the young blokes have really stood up and be counted this year.
Billy, the hot and cold form of most of the sides in the Premiership this year, the 26 rounds, a little bit too long, do you think, or are you quite settled with it?
Oh, it's a long time block, yeah, but I think the break during the State of Origin will do a lot of teams a lot of good, but I suppose then that's very hard for the blokes that have got to keep backing up after rep games. So it is very hard, and I suppose you can look at some of the top players might be playing something like 34 games this year or something. So it's a long time, but you know, we're professionals, and you know, we're paid to do that sort of thing, and you know, we're pretty settled with it by now, I suppose.
Billy, Pat Mulihan here, mate. As far as that goes, one thing that seems to be a bit of a problem at the moment for teams is the fact that we've got 14 sides and we've got a top eight still. I mean, is that one of the things that's stopping teams from breaking away at the moment?
I think everyone's just really clamouring to stay in that top eight. It's still very hard, you know. Like you said, the competition's very topsy-turvy, and any team on their day can win, you know, as we've seen on more than one occasion this year. So it's a strange one, having more than half the competition's going to make the semis.
I was going to say, do you think we'd get a bit more consistency if there was only five spots to play for rather than eight?
Well, I don't really think so, because at the end of the day, you're going out as Block and MG and that. No, you're going out to win the football game, and the fact of really where you're sitting at the time doesn't really make that much difference. I know that probably sounds silly, but you know, you strap your boots on to win. You don't go out there to come second. So, you know,
good point.
I don't know whether that'd make the consistency anymore.
Billy, what about you? Even with unlimited interchange, you used to play virtually the entire 80 minutes. Now, I'm not going to say you're old, but you are 31, and probably the coach isn't too much older than you, but you'd have to be pretty happy with your form. Your stats so far this year are pretty good, you know, over 14 hit-ups per game and about 17 tackles per game. And you can also find the try line a little bit, eh?
Yeah, I've been a little bit lucky in that regard lately, I suppose, but I suppose my tackling's down a little bit on the last couple of years.
I thought I'd give you a break.
Yeah, but I just don't know why that is. I suppose I'm just a little bit lucky to to get away with a little bit less defence, so I can probably try and concentrate that a little bit more in attack. So, but games sort of change and seasons change. You know, some days you might be called upon to make 38 tackles, and other days you might be, you know, 15. So that's just the way the game goes, I suppose. But in answering your question, I'm very happy with the limited interchange. It makes it a lot better for blokes that are a bit smaller. You can sort of grind a game out a little bit more.
Yeah. Bill, you know Joey John's better than anyone. I think he's the best player in the game. I think we all agree here. It just looked to me in the start of the season he took too much upon himself. Do you think he's settled into the season a bit better now? Scored a number of tries last week and plenty of goals.
Yeah, I think he has settled in really well. You know, he is the best player in the world as far as I'm concerned, so I agree with you there. But, I don't know, it is hard. Like everyone at the start of the year is getting into a fresh year and trying to work themselves into the way they're going to play for the year. So to say that he probably put a bit of pressure on himself, you're probably right. But nine and a half times out of ten, if he's got pressure on himself, he's going to perform. He's just that sort of bloke. He thrives on the kick from the sideline in the last minute to win the game. You know, that's just his... the way his makeup is, he loves that sort of thing. So probably if he puts pressure on himself, it's good for us.
He's a good man to have out there, isn't he? Already 70 points so far this season for Andrew Johns, and also inspirational in defence, probably one of the best front-on defenders going around in the NRL. Billy, this Raiders side, they've got Jason Croker coming back, Anthony Colella coming back, and Captain Simon Wolford returning from injury. So this is probably one of their best teams they've put out there. And young Brett Finch there at halfback, he was your ball boy when first came into grade, eh?
I think he was one of our ball boys when we first started, but he's progressed a long way since then, and he's probably one of their strike players this year. So it's a big effort from him, and we caught him on probably a bad week the way they've got all their gun players coming back. So it'll be a good challenge for us. We haven't won down there at Bruce before, so the boys are really keen to get out and put a good performance in. So. Should be a good one, I think.
Billy, just on your team again, mate, when Matty Johns left to go to Wigan at the start of this year, there was a lot of pressure put on Rudder. I think he's performed probably above expectations this year. And what do you think about him?
Yeah, I agree with you, MG. A lot of pressure was put on Rudds, especially since the injury to Matt Gidley. You know, there was a bit of talk about him playing 5-8, but young Rudds, he's really stepped up to the mark, and he's got better with every game, and he's just playing tremendous for us, given probably... took a little bit of pressure off Andrew Johns. You were talking before, Johns, he put a lot of pressure on himself. I think Rudsy, the way he's playing lately, has given Andrew that little bit more freedom. So
he's pretty quick too, isn't he? He's pretty quick.
Well, he's quick and big. So
I think the thing I like about Rudder is the way he steers the ship around for Newcastle.
Yeah,
literally.
The
Rudder.
I was
over Billy's head. Billy,
I'll tell you what,
I'm pretty slow, mate. I'm pretty slow.
You're okay.
It'd be a bit of pressure on a rookie coach like Hagan. I know that he's coaching the lower grades. You put someone in there, but he's left him there, hasn't he? He's showed his full faith in him, and he started to come good.
Mm. Billy, that's as right, well. Yeah, to his credit.
Billy, as well, there's a bit of mail about Adam McDougall possibly being out with a groin strain. Have you spoken to Mad Dog, or more importantly, has Mad Dog spoken to his groin?
Or to anyone?
I hope he's been praying to his groin, actually, to get it right. He's handy to have out there, the big boy. So, you know, obviously, if he's out, we'll sorely miss him. But, we've had some good young blokes, blokes like Justin Ryder in the past, come up and fill the holes and be very good for us. So I think if... if the unfortunate happens and Dougs is out, one of the young blokes will come up and hold their head up, I'd say.
Yeah, Billy, Newcastle, they defeated the Warriors last week, but in round 8, the Warriors are playing the Bulldogs at Wellington, and already 20,000 tickets have been pre-sold for this game in Wellington. Kickoff is at 5:30 p.m. on Saturday. Now, you've been around for a fair while, Billy. The Bulldogs are in good form, but so too the New Zealand Warriors. They're a different sort of side this year, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. The Bulldogs, obviously, probably one of the main attacking sides this year. They're really throwing the ball around, and they're an exciting side to watch. And obviously, Auckland are as well, you know, coming away with a tight win over Brisbane the other week. So they can't be discounted. And that's great to see for the game that there's such a big crowd over at Wellington. It's probably somewhere that hasn't had too many games.
It's amazing.
It's tremendous.
What a mismatch that was when Tricky and Darren Britt came together. Who was your back in that tussle, Billy Peden? Darren Britt against Tricky in a fight.
Depends. I don't know. I'd say you'd have to go with the size there, wouldn't you, boys? I don't know.
Depends, mate.
I've never seen either of them fight.
Mate, what about this record at Bruce Stadium? For the Newcastle Knights, of course, have been such a great side over the past 6 or 7 years. You've never won down there at Bruce Stadium. I think you've been there 7 times and you've walked away every time defeated.
Yeah, it's just one of those funny things that happens in rugby league. I think we were very close, not last year, the year before. I think we had a draw down there and it was sort of a last minute thing. We were in front right to the death. So, you know, I don't think it's anything to worry about too much. You know, we've got a lot of new faces in the side, so a lot of the boys wouldn't remember many of the losses down there. So it's a fresh sort of slate as far as we're concerned. We're just going down there to win the game of footy and enjoy it. So that should be a real good one. I think it'll be very physical.
And just finally, Ben Kennedy, the first time he'll be back at Bruce Stadium after leaving in controversial circumstances. How's he feeling? He'll cop a razz.
Yeah, he'll probably cop a bit of a razz, but as Andrew Johns is that sort of player, BK, he'll stand up when the pressure's on. He's done it for us before, and I can guarantee he'll do it again. He'll enjoy the challenge down there, and he'll probably go close to man of the match, I'd say. He's very keen and a great player, so look for a big one from him.
Hey, Billy, thanks for your time tonight and coming into our Prime Studios up there in Newcastle, and good luck, and come away with a win in Canberra.
My pleasure. Thanks, boys.
See you, Billy.
See you, mate.
There he is, Billy Peaton, the lock forward for the Newcastle Knights, joining us live from Newcastle.
Got to add too, how underrated of a player is he?
He's unlucky not to get a rep jumper, isn't he?
Great player. He might be a lot of Cole Vandervoort.
Yeah, he's the best clean-up merchant in the game.
And always there backing up. I mean, we saw that against the Storm. He was there when Adam McDougall was away, and who was there but Billy Peaton.
Yep.
Does a tremendous job. Well, with the first Origin only 4 weeks away, we sent Mark Guy to the streets to find out who should be the Blues halfback, Brett Camorley or Andrew Johns.
The halfback for the start of Origin this year, Camorley or Johns?
Camorley.
Playing well.
Playing well, like, you know, he's a bit struggling over Manly at the moment, but, you know, he's just got to get a bit of backup and he'll be right.
Well, that'll be a tough call, I reckon, because they're both even players as far as I'm concerned, you know.
Johns.
I'd probably prefer Johns. I think Johns deserves it.
Alfie Langer. Alfie, Alan. Hello, how you going, mate? Welcome back from England. Do you think it'd be Johns or Camorley halfback?
Who's that?
They're soccer players from Europe.
You're asking the wrong person.
Camorley. Two great players, but I just think that Camorley's done nothing wrong.
No, Johns for sure.
Do you follow rugby league?
No.
Not at all?
Not at all.
Oh, there's, what's that, $4,000? Gee whiz.
No. We don't understand, actually.
Yeah. What sport do you follow?
What sport? Yeah. Softball.
And what about the halfback this year for the State of Origin? Do you think it's going to be either Johns, Camorley or Mark Shulman?
Mark Shulman.
Yeah. Thanks, mate.
Good on you.
Okay.
We're out of time on NRL Winners. Until next Thursday night, goodbye for now.
This has been a C7 Sport production.
Now turning to our match here this afternoon, and young prop Clint Newton gets another chance in first grade this afternoon. Last year he played in the Junior Kangaroos alongside some pretty good company, players like Braithen Astor, Brett Finch, the Canberra half, and also Ashley Harrison from the Broncos. He gets another chance in first grade this week after making his debut last weekend against the Warriors, and here is young Clint's reaction to making first grade yet again.
Yeah, man, it's fantastic to see that Hags has got some confidence in me after last week's performance against Auckland. So, mate, I'm just happy to get another run and hopefully I can do a good job. Hags has just firstly told me to go out and play the way I always play, and that's just try and just do my best, and hopefully that's good enough to hold a spot.
The other games, Canberra started brightly in their clash with Newcastle this afternoon. Kenny Nagus barging over for a try after 10 minutes. The Knights' Darren Albert was sent to the sin bin for a professional foul, and the Raiders took full advantage for a 12-0 lead.
The former Knights ball boy has swelled over as easy as you like.
Tamana Tahu then brought Newcastle back into the match with two tries just before the break. The Knights hit the lead late in the second half. Andrew John's boot proving the difference here. Newcastle holding on for a slender 22 points to 20 win.
Game between Canberra and Newcastle went down to the wire, with the Knights levelling in the closing minutes.
Kennedy slams it down!
At 20-all, another draw looked likely this weekend, but when Finch put the ball out on the full from a 20-metre drop kick, Newcastle received a penalty in front. Johns converted as full-time sounded.
Off the boot, successful!
And a costly mistake from the Raiders against Newcastle.
Newcastle's hopes of their first win in Canberra look shaky when former Knights ball boy Brett Finch crossed to make it 12-0. The three times Newcastle came back to level. The final time when former Raider Ben Kennedy reached out late. Then Finch went from hero to villain at the death. His restart out on the full. Johns with a gift match winner. His opposite reduced to tears. Patrick Mullahan, 7 News.
Meantime, Canberra rookie Brett Finch has spoken of the disappointment following yesterday's mistake, which cost his team a draw against Newcastle.
Babyface Raider Brett Finch was a day older, but definitely a lot wiser as he recalled the horror mistake which cost his side the game.
Yeah, I was playing for the win. I wasn't really happy with the draw at that stage. No, I wanted to win the game.
But when his kick went out on the full, the 20-year-old broke down in tears, unable to watch as Knight Andrew John slotted the match winner. Today, as John swam with son Samuel, his thoughts were still with Finch, and he revealed what he'd said to console the one-time Newcastle ball boy.
You know, if you go out on a limb and take risks and you make mistakes, you just got to wear it, and I said he'd be better play for it.
That's the way it goes. Next time I might consult Captain Simon Wolfe, because he wasn't too happy with the outcome, I don't think.
Ben Kennedy wasn't so sympathetic. He left the Raiders on bad terms at the end of 1999.
But I'd be lying, mate, if I didn't say that. It was a good feeling at the end of the game.